Call the meeting to order. Okay, welcome to the March meeting of the Department of Natural Resources here in beautiful Edgefield. Well, it was beautiful yesterday, but it's kind of raining today. I'd like to first of all read the Freedom of Information Statement. Notice of this meeting has been provided to all persons, organizations, and news media which have requested notification as required by 30-4-80 of the South Carolina Code of Laws. I'd also like to ask you if you have any electronic devices, cell phones, pads, tablets, please silence them or cut them off. At this time, we'll have our invocation, and I will conduct that. Let's bow our heads. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the many blessings you have given to us. We also thank you for all the people that have come before us and fought the good fight to protect our natural resources and make them sustainable. We pray that as we finish our duty here, that we will be remembered as people that fought the good fight and did the right things to leave things for our children and grandchildren in the future. Now, as we conduct this business, we pray that you will be with us, guide and direct your thoughts and actions, and may the things that we do be pleasing unto you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen.
Okay, Pledge of Allegiance. Vice Chairman Kerry Chastain will lead us in that.
We stand.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Kerry. At this time, we'll ask Deputy Director of Marine Resources, Robert Bowles, to introduce our guest.
Sir, good morning, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. We're pleased to have a number of guests here. Certainly, we'd like to extend our appreciation and thanks to George Thornton and National Wild Turkey Federation for having us here. He's joined with NWTF by Dave Malky as well, Doug Sanders, and Lynn Lewis Weiss as well, from NWTF. We've got a couple of folks from Aiken Soil and Water Conservation District, so Yvonne Kelly and Linda Lee, and finally Greg Henderson and Dwight Davis from Cyclone Association of Conservation Districts are here as well. And I believe Mr. Henderson has requested the opportunity to speak before the board, Mr. Chairman.
Okay.
And I think that's everyone.
Okay. First of all, I believe Mr. Thornton would like to say a few words, or at least introduce himself.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You already had our staff introduced a little bit about them. Doug Saunders, back here, is our Vice President of Strategy and Development, and he is a recovering Ducks Unlimited employee. We started rehabilitating him 4 or 5 years ago, and we're making some progress, and a very welcome addition to our staff. As a big part of our portfolio, including strategy, and is very involved in Save the Habitat, Save the Hunt, which you'll hear more about later. Dave Malky, to my left, is our Vice President of Volunteer Relations and Operations. Dave was a long-serving national board member. He's here from Wisconsin. He is now in the category of Damn Yankee. He moved down here and bought a house. And so he's moved out him, and he left the snow shovel at home.
And the snowblower.
Dave not only served on our national board, but then became a regional director and then a regional field supervisor and then moved in here. So he's in this vice presidency role, so he's touched virtually every aspect of the organization. It's also a very welcome addition. And Lynn Lewis Weiss, who many of you know, is a regional biologist, and I can say without exaggeration that Lynn sets the standard for a regional biologist. She's somebody that we look to with great confidence and enjoy working with. So this is our staff. I'm going to offer a presentation after you finish your business. That'll take 20 minutes or so, and then we'll provide a tour of the new facility for those of you that are interested. And we take a lot of pride in showing that off. I'll say this 3 or 4 times today, but that facility that you're going to see would not be would not be possible without your generosity and cooperation. So, as you know, y'all provided the seed money for it. I trust you'll be pleased with what you see. We get a few questions about the operation here. We have 250 employees nationwide. About 140 of them are on site here. It's a very complex business. We, of course, have all the business functions of chief financial officer and controller. But we publish our magazines here, which go out every 2 months to about 250,000 people. We produce in-house about 52 television shows a year. And we put together in our warehouse all of the packages that you've seen at our banquets. And we ship those out to 1,700 destinations nationwide. We print about 40,000 prints here every year. And we start with framing, we cut the glass, we cut the mats, and we actually print the prints here. So they're all American-made. And we sell about 35,000 guns out of our gun room out here. So it's a fairly complex organization. Last year, we raised about $70 million through the generosity of our members nationwide. We've got about 250,000 members now, and that's pretty stable. We're seeing a lot of interest in hunting heritage and preserving the lifestyle that we all love. So we're feeling very, very good about where we are and about the support we're getting from you and people like yourselves, and we're thrilled to have y'all here. This is a real honor for us. If you need anything at all, Chairman, you know where my office is. Kathy's here. Doug, Dave, any of us can help with anything y'all need, and hope you have a productive meeting.
Yeah. George, we want to thank you for letting us use your facility here. Now, this is a national headquarters for the Wild Turkey Federation. If you don't believe it, take a look at some of those board of directors. They're from all over the Southeast and the country, really.
Yeah.
George is going to give us a tour and his staff, and he wants to have a count for how many people that we're going to take. So if you're going to go on the tour, because he wants to provide a tour guide per car due to the weather. So if you'll raise your hand if you plan to go on the tour afterwards, everybody raise your hand if you plan to go. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. About 15?
No problem at all.
Suit
you. Okay.
Okay.
Sorry.
Thank you, George.
Thank you.
Appreciate the use of your facility.
No, call if you need anything.
Okay. And now, Robert?
Yes, sir. Greg Henderson would like an opportunity to present, make some comments to the board, Mr. Chair.
Yes, Greg.
First of all, I want to welcome you to Edgefield. I work as a county extension agent here, and I work very closely with peach growers, and Larry's one of our pristine clients that we work. And Tuesday was the peak, so if we could go back to Tuesday to have this meeting, it would have been the most beautiful time to be in Edgefield County. I also serve as a soil and water commissioner. I have, for the past 30 years, and I represent South Carolina on our national association, board. And we just finished our state meeting, and Bob Perry came, and we had our national CEO, Jeremy Peters from DC, came down, and we talked about water issues, water of the U.S., and of course alluded to the Surface Water Withdrawal Act. Those discussions don't take place on a much higher plane, and thankfully after the department's capacity studies are complete, where we have more complete information to work on those. But I was president of our state association when we adopted or discussed the first legislation that we're working under now. It was not an easy process then, and it's not going to be an easy process now with some of the changes. But one of the things I do want to bring you up on is we have a National Resolutions Committee that each year we provide input to D.C. to what areas of interest or concerns come from the states. These go into the National Farm Bill legislation on how monies are divided up within USDA. Any of the cost share programs that come down to private landowners for natural resource protection or wildlife enhancement through USDA to private landowners really begin with the conservation districts and our association working closely with those with input from our clientele and our constituents and our partners, such as the Land, Water, and Conservation Division that Ken heads up. But feral hogs are on the they're really coming to be an issue. Our partner state in Mississippi put forth a resolution with some means on how we can address the issue of feral hogs. I think they're probably overpassing coyotes as an area of concern statewide now. When I start seeing them, you know, on my farm or evidence of them on my farm, then that's getting close and real to me. But how private landowners can do this, we have very liberal deprivation policies that we can adhere to. We can, I think, trap state year-wide with that. But, you know, that's a cost and not really successful when where you have high populations. And I was just on the phone with my counterpart from Walterboro, and hogs are, with the rainfall and the swamps being flooded, they're more of an issue this spring with our spring planted crops already destroying corn, early planted corn in the low state. So we proposed to USDA, much like any other widespread pest, some assistance in designing a cost share program where landowners can receive assistance through the Farm Bill for wild hog, I guess, abatement or removal. And this would be mass removal. You know, we're talking about Jagapro, that type of a trap where you come in and you collect the whole group. This can be quite expensive. So that has gone up to D.C. as for consideration by the Secretary to put that into whether it's a conservation stewardship type of a program or a standalone cost share program to eradicate this pest. Clearest example of that would be the boll weevil or the screwworm. Problem is that those were specific to a particular host plant or a host animal. This one has no preference.
We can't spray for them. Like, okay.
Can't spray for them. You know, when you start talking about, I guess, chemical means of control, Lord knows, I know, remember when Clemson had a problem with squirrels, we started castrating squirrels and giving the females birth control pills. You can't do that with hogs. The only way to do is to eliminate them. So that's just something that we do. Not everyone knows how broadly involved we are. We have phone conferences every month to discuss the progress of this. It's just a pleasure to work with y'all. Thank you for allowing me to speak.
Thank you very much. The conservation districts, of course, do more with the less of any group that I know, and y'all do a fantastic job. We appreciate it.
We have a great partner and a great director now.
We do.
We do.
But we appreciate any help.
Mr. Chairman, yes, I would also like to say, you know, there are no better partners in the conservation districts, and we've formed a real strong relationship and partnership. And something we may can do, and we can talk about this later, something we may can do is also draft a letter in support of cost share to the Secretary from our agency, or maybe from New York.
And we utilize a lot of the data collection from that National Feral Hog database in looking at the population projections, and I think that was done with DNR, all the natural resource agencies doing that. So that was a valuable asset to put in front of USDA, where you don't have to go back and reinvent, you know, the data to support your request. It's very real. It's striking.
We appreciate you taking the time to come in and talk to us. We are trying to schedule the board meetings kind of scattered across the state, so we give the constituents an opportunity to come in and tell us what they think, because we're here representing you, and not ourselves, you. So thank you.
Yes, Kenny. Mr. Chairman, if I could add, I very much appreciate the work that the conservation districts do, and there are a lot of ways we work together. And one of the things that I mentioned that we're very excited about working with you on, I mentioned at your conference, is the water planning activity that we're in the process of doing. When we get to the regional and basin-wide water plans, conservation districts have that local knowledge that's so important and adds a lot to what we're trying to do. So we look forward to continuing that relationship. Appreciate it. Glad you're here.
Okay, thanks. Thank you, Mr. Bowles. In the board packet that went out, you got the minutes from the February 6th meeting. Hope you've had a chance to review those. I entertain a motion to approve.
I'd like to approve.
I have a motion to approve. Second?
Second.
Okay, got a motion and a second. Any discussions? Are there any changes or additions to those minutes? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, no. Presentation, I mean, motion carries. Okay, presentation of accommodations. Anything?
Yes, sir. Just a couple of things. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to bring your attention that we had several of our employees since we met last have been recognized for the work they did. Shannon recognized by the state newspaper this year in the class of 20 under 40. They picked 20 professionals in the Midlands, and then they recognized them for the work they do, and she was recognized. We had an opportunity to participate in that presentation for her, and it was quite an honor to have our chief counsel recognized for the work that she does and the standing she has within the community. Also would like to recognize, it's not on your list, Officer or Investigator Greg Brown. Greg Brown works in our investigative section, doing fatality investigations, marine theft investigations and such. And he was recognized as the National Investigator of the Year at a recent conference. And we will probably, when we're in May, when we're in Charleston, we'll get Greg to come before us so we can all thank him for the work he does. But it's very noteworthy that he received that national honor, you know, honor as being selected as Investigator of the Year in that field for the entire country. So, real proud of him. Also, my chairman, Mr. Glenn McFadden, was recognized as well. He was just York County Chamber of Commerce just bestowed upon our chairman Lifetime Business Achievement Award. Says a lot of community work and things doing community. Glenn, we wanted to recognize you for that.
Appreciate it
as well. We just had our Conservation District annual conference in Columbia. All of Kent's staff needs to be applauded for the work they did to put that on. If any of you have ever been involved in putting on any type of conference, there's a lot to be done. And Ken staff, Mark Cribb, Dorothy, and other members of the staff that want to come out and put that conference on. Just now while we're here.
Yeah.
And Mr. Chairman, that's all I have.
Well, I know I speak for the whole board in saying that these people that have been committed and recognized at DNR, we would like for you to know how much we appreciate that and keep up the good work. Okay. All right, at this time we'll have our advisory committee reports. First up is law enforcement. Mr. Norman Fulham is chairman. Norman.
Okay. Our last meeting was on February the 10th, and my minutes show that it was a Donnelly. If it was a Donnelly, I wasn't there. It was in Columbia. We had all members present except one, which was an excused absence. And we had a very good meeting. And one highlight that really went over well with law enforcement was Dr. Hope Mizell's climatology report. Our board had no idea the in-depth that our climatology department, hydrology, and all that information. Any of the other advisory committees, I would recommend that you try to get Dr. Mizell, some of her staff, to give that presentation. We were able to do, by having it in Columbia, we were able to have the board and all. And I had calls afterwards from several people. And what they wanted, my board, advisory board, wanted to hear more from different agency divisions of DNR, find out what's going on, because the only thing they had in the past is the law enforcement. But it was well received. Major things went through. General Franklin reported on the waterfowl totals and new rank structure, the reoccurring money the governor had put in her budget for vehicle purchases. We currently have 250 officers, and we've gotten as low as 190, so we're making great progress there. We distributed a new law enforcement supervisory map. And we recently hired new officers and a new pilot. We've got somewhere between 70 and 80 officers that have to participate in bike weekends coming up, Memorial Day, and I talked to a couple of majors who had just been down there, and they weren't, nobody's too happy with that duty, but it has to be done. We've got six officers that are going to Carolina Command College for training, put on by the South Carolina Chapter of the FBI National Academy. Major Poole and Major Landers attended a 3-week training in West Virginia, put on by the National Association of Conservation Law Enforcement Chiefs. Colonel Hope, 14 chiefs from across the nation for 1-week NACLEC conference. Airplane 206 is back in action. I think it was being painted at the time.
Yes, sir.
In North Carolina. Currently, we have 108 non-departmental deputy law enforcement officers, and they did over 7,000 volunteer hours in 2014. Director Taylor then updated us on legislative issues and the DNR budget. At the moment, we're managing over 1 million acres in wildlife management area land, the $110 million agency, and the General Assembly only funds 20 million of that. That's 1-6. Captain Billy Downey gave us a presentation on hunter education, archery in the schools, and shooting sports programs. We've got 271 schools participating now in archery, and over 30,000 children participating. We had a couple other presentations, and that concluded the meeting.
Okay, very good.
Very active.
Any questions, Mr. Poole? Okay, next up is Wildlife and Freshwater Fisheries, Chairman Mike Hutchins.
Hi. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Our Wildlife and Freshwater Fisheries Advisory Board met at Donnelly on the same day on the 10th. We had full house as well, and we were honored to have Elizabeth join us, and it's great to have her. The committee heard constituent comments from Georgetown Sportsman Coalition, who was concerned about waterfowl hunting in the area, also expressed need for more law enforcement officers in the area, and an educational program to teach youth how to better waterfowl hunting. DNR wildlife biologist Ms. Christy Hand reported on wood storks and stated that in 2014 the federal status of the species was downlisted from endangered to threatened. She stated that 2014 was a record year for stork nesting with a total of 2,501 nests statewide. And ongoing projects included colony and ground surveys, individual nesting monitoring, chick banding, and habitat management. DNR fisheries biologist Bill Post reported on sturgeon monitoring and noted that short-nosed sturgeon and Atlantic sturgeon occur throughout rivers and estuaries along the Atlantic coast. Since 2010, approximately 600 ultrasonic receivers were placed in major rivers and waterways in South Carolina, North Carolina, and Georgia as a joint effort to capture the movement of all tagged sturgeon. The study is continuing, but the data provided so far has dramatically changed the conventional thinking for both species. Michael Hook, field supervisor for DNR's Aquatic Nuisance Species Program, presented a brief history of the aquatic management program and explained a plan is developed annually and approved by the Aquatic Plant Management Council annually. The plan covers approximately 50 to 60 water bodies throughout the state and addresses problems such as hydrilla and how to combat it. Committee members Stephen Thomas and Bobby Garmany volunteered to work with Wildlife and Freshwater Fisheries Division on aquatic plant issues, particularly in the Santee Cooper water system. Emily Cope updated us on the current legislative bills, including those on turkey and deer management. The meeting was adjourned, followed by lunch and a tour of Donnelly given by biologist Dean Herzl. Our next meeting is Tuesday, May 5th in Columbia.
Very good, Mike. Any questions? Okay, next up is Land, Water, and Conservation. Ken Retiro, Director of Land, Water, and Conservation. Ken?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. The Land, Water, and Conservation Division's Advisory Committee met February 17th, and they were provided with program and budget updates, and we discussed some of the accomplishments in the division over the past year. They also approved, for your consideration, 13 reappointments and 4 new appointments to district commissioner positions, and those will be presented to you later in the day. And Next meeting is scheduled for May 19th. That's all I have.
Thank you very much. Any questions, Ken?
Mr. Chairman, yes. A comment referencing Ken's report. There was just a report out of California this week about how critical their water shortage is going to be next year. In terms of saying that water is going to run out in California, with that being said, we have discussion in our legislature about some water legislation. And there are groups that oppose that. But what's happening in California, I think DNR should be acutely aware that there needs to be an approach to not overregulate our water usage, especially in agriculture. But we have, when we get this river basin study accomplished, we can see where our water originates. We mostly know where it originates. It's not a gigantic area that we receive our water from. So with that point being, the DNR should have a position, irregardless of what some of the organizations that say they represent agriculture. I've had a conversation with Senator Kempson about it. And we need to monitor that closely. We don't need a carte blanche withdrawal of water from any source of our water assets, but we don't need to overregulate. But we do need to proceed, and hopefully with Ken, with the study that DNR is accomplishing, that will set the stage for some type of reasonable, common sense approach to water usage in our state.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. I think water might be one of our most precious resources. We are blessed with good groundwater, and to preserve that in such a way that it's sustainable, it is something we should be conscious of. I think we also have test wells drilled over the state monitoring the level of that water so that we get some good science on if it is starting to be depleted, that we can kind of judge that and make good common sense decisions. I couldn't agree more.
Mr. Chairman, haven't we already addressed this with you in DHEC and the study going on?
Yeah, we have. And that's the real, and I go back what Mr. Yance says with, the scientific approach that we're taking now met with a lot of uncertainty from some of the user groups. And we've stood firm that if we're going to have a scientific approach and we're going to go in and we're going to look at our surface water, which is what we're doing now, and we should follow some groundwater work as well, and we're doing some of that now too, that the scientific approach then is going to lead to better decisions because it's based on good science. And we've got better opportunities for good science now than way before the last Surface Water Control Act was put in place. And there were a lot of gnashing of teeth during that last debate on surface water withdrawal, which led us to where we are now with approaching it from a very sound scientific approach. And I think that's what's going to be most important at the end of the day, that we can put all the information on the table and you can say, this was done without any bias. It's a sound scientific approach to it. So, the best we can come up with.
We've already got a start.
Yeah.
And
to culminate what's going on with Senator Campson's legislation, is there's some initiatives by some people in this state that are advertising our state as a no restriction water usage state, and advertising for West Coast farms to move to South Carolina because we have no restrictions on our water uses. That's devastating. I'm telling you, that is not good for our state. So that's all the more reason that hopefully we can generate this scientific information that people in power can take this information and make reasonable decisions.
That sounds good. I'd like to mention one thing, Ken. I spent the day with Ken's archaeologist over at, is it Cole, John?
Cole site.
Yeah. I spent the day on a shovel. There's a lot of physical, hard physical labor in archaeology, but I was really amazed at how thorough and scientific they are, and the records they keep, and every chip that we found came from the making process, not just the tool itself, but the making of it, and the pottery we found. It was a really great day, and your team out there does a fabulous job.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I can tell you it meant a great deal to them to have a chairman be there, first of all, but to actually get in the pits and dig and find a few artifacts. That meant the world to them, so we really appreciate it. The only downside to that project was the public day was rained out on Saturday.
I heard that.
The road was washed out, so we couldn't get folks in there, so yeah. That's unfortunate. But
well, maybe next year.
Appreciate you coming.
Okay, Governor's Cup, bill fishing series. Is it that time again, Mr.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. The Governor's Cup Bill Fishing Series Advisory Board met Wednesday, February 18th in Charleston. The Governor's Cup Board welcomed new board member Stokely Holder to the board. Mr. Holder replaces Jamie Zachrick, who retired the board in February. Recall that Mr. Holder was lined up to take on a new term starting July the 1st, but with Mr. Zachrick's resignation, that was bumped up. So we welcome Mr. Holder. It was a singular Governor's Cup board meeting, and I say singular in my years sitting as an ex officio member of that board. Never seen the amount of public interest turned out with respect to guests at the Governor's Cup board. We had a group of concerned officials and businessmen from Edisto Island and the Edisto Marine Association, and they were there simply to say Governor's Cup is good for Edisto. They would very much like to see a tournament in the series continued at Edisto. Recall that there is a rule in the Governor's Cup series guidelines that there are no more than five tournaments. Due to some contractual issues in Edisto, the Edisto tournament that was scheduled for this summer, 2015, will not be a part of the Governor's Cup series. And Mr. Chairman, because it involved a contractual issue, if there are questions about that, I'd be happy to answer that, but maybe better at a later time. But there was, suffice it to say, a great deal of interest in the Edisto community for the Governor's Cup to continue to be present there. So that was very heartening to see.
Yes,
that. Another heartening moment, if I may, a board member and Memorial Reef Foundation founder, C.D. Leisure, asked the Governor's Cup board to consider taking over and managing the Memorial Reef project. There's still, as you all know, the Memorial Reef initial deployments have all gone. They continue to receive private donations into that program, and the founder and the emotional force, a lot of the emotional force behind that, Stevie Leisure, has asked the Governor's Cup board to consider managing that project moving forward in the sense that this was a project designed for, the Memorial Reef was a project designed for and by blue water fishermen. So the Governor's Cup board agreed to do that, and I thought that was a great vote of confidence in the Governor's Cup program. A number of discussions about the planned expenditures for 2015, as well as more discussions about outreach were had by the board. A couple of motions. The motion was approved, the proposed expenditures as presented. Mark Rogers was nominated and selected as Governor's Cup Vice Chairman. Also, there was a motion to reappoint to a second term Stevie Leisure, Tommy Hancock, and Bucky Morris to the second term. That paperwork is in process, and it will be coming to you all for your consideration and further action at a later meeting. Mr. Chairman, the next proposed meeting of the Governor's Cup Board is scheduled for, if necessary, April the 30th. If not, August the 27th. Both of those will be at the Marine Center. And I'd just like to remind the board, a lot of discussion about the annual awards banquet. Last year, you know, we made a change in venue and had it down on John's Island at the Island House. There was a lot of positive feedback with that change. And so we've got a date. This will be on your calendar, but just so you all will know, Friday, September the 25th is this planned meeting for the awards banquet. And, Mr. Chairman, that concludes my report.
Good. Robert, I would like to say thanks to Mr. Pulliam. I know Mr. Holder.
Yes.
And he is a fine guy.
Well, this is his son, you know.
Oh, it's his son.
You know, Ed used to be on, served his term
terms out, and okay. Vice chairman, but this is his son who's very active.
I've met him also.
Yes,
he's quite a fisherman.
Yes,
he knows offshore.
He's a great snorkeler.
Yeah. Any questions of Mr. Bowen?
Thank you, Mr.
Chairman. Okay, next up is migratory waterfowl. That's me. We went over the new duck stamp print. It's a hooded merganser. Pass it around, let y'all see it. We thought we're getting a lot of interest, and we think it's a really good quality print that'll be coming out pretty soon, won't it?
Yes.
Yeah. Then we had a presentation by Craig LeShank of Ducks Unlimited. He talked about our donations in the past. It turns out that DNR has contributed something to Ducks Unlimited for 50 straight years. We're only one state out of three that has actually done that. Last year, we contributed $21,713 as our contribution to the DU, which goes to protect habitat up in Canada. We proposed $30,435 for this year, and that was approved. Now, Craig went on to say that the $21,713 we gave last year was matched by Ducks Unlimited, which meant that that was $43,426. And then when it went to Canada, Canada matched that. So our $21,000 turned into $86,875, and that will happen also again on the $30,000. And that since in the last 50 years that we have donated $2.7 million to Ducks Unlimited, and that through the matching process over those years amounted to about $80 million that we have contributed. Our health contributors. The $30,000 this year will be spent around Ontario because 25% of the ducks that are collected in South Carolina come from Ontario. So that was pretty much what we talked about. Our next meeting is scheduled for August the 5th at the DNR board meeting room in Columbia. Yes, Mr. Pogue.
Our actual contributions are much higher than that. South Carolina is second per capita in the United States in the number of life numbers of DU and above, which amounts to substantial contributions.
Yeah, yeah, I would say.
And several of our board members, past and present, are life numbers.
Yeah, thank you.
Well, we all, and the partnership goes beyond that. The partnership goes to how much stuff Unlimited has put back on the ground in South Carolina through NOCA grants.
Yeah.
Much by waterfowl work that we do, and a lot of private landowners, waterfowl work they're doing on their properties across South Carolina come directly through dollars that are matched in NOCA grants that come from the DU.
Yeah.
And so lots of times we talk about the money that goes out of South Carolina, out of the country, within the flyway for those nesting grounds, but at the same time, there's a lot of money from DU invested in our state, probably more than goes out. With NOCA grants, they give back to us. So it's a great partnership that's lasted for 50 years.
50 years, yeah. He also said that South Carolina will be recognized at this year's national conference, and that Director Taylor will be there to receive that award. So that's really great. All right, next up is Marine Chairman Kerry Chastain.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The Marine Advisory Committee met this past Friday at 10 o'clock at Venice Point at the McKenzie Field Station. If you've never driven down Venice Point Road, which I have not, I encourage you to do so if you're south of Charleston off 17 and spend an extra 30 minutes. It is a beautiful drive, about 15 miles. We had some really good presentations. Deputy Director Bowles gave us a presentation on the Marine Resources Division and their major accomplishments for 2014, which were many. Phil Mayer gave an overview of the MRD partnerships that have been developed in the Ace Basin. And then we had a commercial licensing and permitting breakdown of the Marine commercial license, excuse me, for 2015, and that was provided by the supervisor for that, Angel Brown. Very interesting. Mike Denson, he gave us a COBIA update, and what is very interesting about COBIA, and he's only been able to really learn this really in the last 5 years as a result of genetic research. And I asked Deputy Director Bowles to please chime in if I don't get this right. But basically, the federal government manages our COBIA fishery, and they're finding that they measure it in poundage, and it's actually increased slightly or remained flat, so it appears very, very healthy. And then DNR releases COBIA from Waddell into the Port Royal Sound, and then you have the what is really a local population of COBIA. And those are the COBIA that South Carolina, that we're catching in South Carolina. Through the genetic research, which is incredibly interesting, is these three different sources of COBIA do not commingle, and they do not spawn together. So we're catching the same COBIA out of Port Royal Sound in the Broad River down there, that is a local COBIA that spawned there, and they act very much like salmon, and they go back to the same waters every year. And so as Robert explained it, it's like fishing out of a pond, and we're depleting that particular COBIA, and that's where the issue could be developing, and that we're overfishing our COBIA. More research is going to be done. There may be a recommendation from the committee later this year, depending on what Mr. Denson learns. And it's very interesting what they're doing with genetic research now. And that concluded our meeting. Our next meeting is in June.
I got a question. Kerry, do they spawn, artificially spawn the cobia like they do the redfish and the sea trout? Do they do that?
They do, at Waddell.
At Waddell?
They grow about at Waddell and stock them out of the ponds, which is why we went to the General Assembly last year, because to get money to help support Waddell. And I think, Robert, correct me if I'm wrong, somewhere in the neighborhood of 1.5 million fish, saltwater variety of fish, have gone back into the coastal waters that are running through Waddell Center to go out and restock. And that's cobia and redfish and trout. But it's a huge, Waddell is a huge resource for those fish in that area, coastal waters.
Yeah. Excellent. Any questions of Mr. Chastain? Okay, next up is the climate update, Hope Manziel, Land, Water, and Conservation Division.
Okay. Good morning, and thank you for always allowing me the opportunity to be here and provide a climate update, and thank you, Mr. Pulliam, for the invitation and the opportunity to present to the Law Enforcement Advisory Committee last month. It was certainly an honor for our office to be represented. Okay, so today's the last official day of winter. Tomorrow begins spring. This week has been that classic transition. As you know, Tuesday, here we were 88 of a high. Today, high of 48, in many places, that is. On the front of your slide, handout here, and I have a couple here if anyone needs one, I just wanted to highlight some of the records. It helps to talk about the spring season in particular, because for South Carolina, and it's interesting, for March, yes, it was quite warm this week, but if you'll notice, the maximum record for high temperature in South Carolina is 99 degrees. Actually happened in 1907, so quite a long time ago. We actually reached 99 degrees in March. Imagine what that would have been like then to those folks, no air conditioning, and then for so early on. And then it's also the record for April, which you have two back-to-back months that our record is actually 99. Now, flashback to this past winter, and we'll segue into the next slide. Was not a very snowy winter for South Carolina. Still some summery coming in. Climatologically, we call winter December, January, and February, so we're still compiling those numbers. Probably only about 6 inches was the actual maximum snowfall at one location. The coldest temperature was -1, and that was captured by our new weather station there at Sassafras Mountain. That you can also see that we're near the winter record low of -19 that happened in 1985. I had to put the next slide, next handout, because as a reminder of why we're all very thankful that we live in South Carolina, and that, did you get one, Mr.?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry. Of Boston. In the news, quite significant to actually break that record snowfall of 108 inches. The Northeast has just had a relentless winter, and really a quite different pattern here in the Southeast. The next is winter temperature rankings, again, December through February. Every box there with a number, and that's a ranking. So what's the temperature ranking for those 3 months based on the average mean temperature? And what you'll see is, yes, it was cooler than normal, not record-breaking, but some sites had the 6th coldest on record. Other sites in the upstate, the 21st coldest on record. You do see a wide range there. Some was just right about normal, but overall in general, it was cooler than normal again, but probably overall generally about that 20th percentile as far as the temperature goes, average temperature goes. Now what about rainfall? 30-day rainfall, for many, you would probably, if you had to guess, you may say it's been a wet winter. And in parts of the state, that has been the case. One slide's going to show 30-day percent of normal. The next will show the 90-day. And the 90-day actually summarizes the winter's rainfall in general. Based on percent of normal, what you see here is green. The PD, very wet. It was indeed a wet winter. Anywhere from 125 to almost 200% of normal rainfall for places in the PD, both 30-day as well as if you go over into the 90-day. Upstate, very different pattern. It's been actually dry in the upstate. This part of the world right here in Edgefield and going north has kind of been that boundary. You get up into Anderson, Oconee, Spartanburg, all the way over to Chester. Those areas have had only about 75% of normal rainfall for the last 30 days as well as for the 90-day period. That then obviously is reflected in the stream flow map that I'll always show you from our USGS gauges there. Green, stream flows are normal to above normal, are anywhere from the 25th to the 75th percentile. Those are right on top of the areas that had the rain, not much surprise. You all know when we talk about water resources, it's very key the rainfall we receive in the winter months because that's when we recharge our groundwater and our surface water. What do you see? A lot of brown dots for the upstate. That's where the steep stream flow gauges are running below the 25th percentile, all the way again from the northern part of the Savannah River Basin over into Rock Hill area. Focusing on a couple of the stream flow gauges for this area of the state, you can see here in the Savannah River Basin, the next one is their Little River. Just a reminder, so the line, the steady line, that's your median daily statistics based on 56 years. And then the one that starts as green and then fluctuates throughout, and this actually goes back, I like to give you 1 year so you can see where we were this time last year in comparison to where we are today with this one gauge in particular. Now what you see is, yes, no, everything's okay. This one's close enough to normal to where it's not a major concern, especially given the current rainfall we're receiving. But if you do notice that only one time really has the line jumped way above the median daily statistic. It's just been hovering right there at the median. You have to go all the way back to late December and up early January to where you saw enough times that the flows were above normal, kind of balance out when you get those low flows. It's really kind of been indicative of what kind of the rainfall they've had here. Just enough to keep the flows right about average. That's going to be the same picture that you're going to see in the next one, which is Saluda River near where it shoals. Notice that one very much stands out. You have to go all the way back to late December and early January before you saw high flows. It's just been steady, and really for the most part, most of the flows have been slightly below normal. Again, close enough to normal where it's not much of a concern. But a surprise to some when it seems, on days like today, when it seems like it's been a really, really wet winter. Lake levels, though, overall, we've had just enough rainfall for, in general, you'll see most of the lakes are right at full, or close enough to full pool. Many times, as you know, with management, unless they're doing some maintenance, they'll like to keep those flows up, or levels up, this time of year. Now, let's look at the Hartwell, Lake Hartwell. The different lines there, as you know, with the guide curves and level one drought, level two drought. Actually, since we last met, the Kiwi Topsoy and some of this is they actually come out of drought based on their criteria. The dots here are the 10-week projection. So from now out to 10 weeks, it's a little below the guide curve, but again, close enough to be considered out of drought. I decided to add in there the rainfall at the bottom just because it is interesting and something to kind of always keep in mind. If you look, the red bars are the average rainfall. That's what you would, climatology said you would receive in the upper Hartwell Basin. The blue is actually what was observed. So if you go all the way back, you see that December was below normal, January was below normal, February was below normal. But it didn't really take that much rainfall to be able to get those lakes back to where they were okay. Certainly not a surplus, but and that's sometimes confusing to folks. I think it takes this record rainfall to be able to replenish, but it really doesn't, so long as you get close enough to normal in the winter months. Now, something I know particular to some of our board members is the next slide, and others is this concern that we've been 88, it's been warm, and what happens? When's that last freeze going to occur? So this next one is the latest spring freeze climatology. The first two columns there, the first one there shows the date of the latest spring freeze. If you look at that, really catches your attention. If you look at Aiken, the latest spring freeze is April 25th. That's a long time away. It's over a month away from we have on record keeping had our latest freeze. Other parts of the state, Newberry, May 2nd. It's a really long time. The median, though, as we know what the median is, looks a little better. If you look at Aiken, March 28th. So even still, we're still, you know, next week, getting into the end of next week, that's just the median time for your latest freeze. Get closer to the coast, and even Walterboro, those had freezes late as April 3rd. Now for the forecast, the seven-day forecast, this actually reflects a lot of what's falling today. Have rain today through tomorrow, and then again possibly on Sunday. And some of the totals here across our southern coast could have over 2 inches. Other parts of the state, it kind of gradates up to still over an inch and a quarter for the upstate 7 day total. Not getting a lot of headlines, but it's we have officially entered an El Nino. I present this every month and say we're in an ENSO watch. It really, and this is those sea surface temperatures in the equatorial Pacific. Doesn't look very much like an El Nino. I even scratched my head because an El Nino is above normal sea surface temperatures in that bullseye region. It's a little displaced, but as explained in the bottom there, basically what's happened is the sea surface temperatures met that criteria across the western and central Pacific, and it's actually been, it's what we call, it's coupled with the atmosphere. The atmosphere is finally connected up with what's happening in the ocean. Really out of sync, we see on El Nino, a typical El Nino develops in the fall, not right here at the first of spring. So it's out of sync, probably going to be a big factor in our weather as we move forward because we get into another driver in spring and summer. NOAA's 8 to 14 day outlook. This does concern me somewhat because the temperatures for the entire eastern United States below normal. We can't see any heavy or hard freeze on the horizon yet, but we can really only see out about 12 days. Now, this pattern, though, doesn't mean a freeze, just means overall below normal. And then a continuation of the precipitation in green would be above normal precipitation. End with the March through May outlook. Not much guidance on temperature. Precipitation, they're saying at least for two-thirds of the state above normal precipitation. Okay? Thank you.
Good. Thank you.
Thank you.
We're praying for you, Larry. Okay, we have a couple of items for board action. First up is the Broad River Mitigation Trust Fund request, and that will be presented by Bob Perry, Director of Environmental Programs. Mr. Perry.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, and Director Taylor. We've got a number of pages in your package here relative to this request. I'm going to focus on a portion of it. Just a quick reminder that in 1996, the state legislature appointed you to be the trustee with authority over the state mitigation trust fund, where various mitigation trust fund monies might be funneled into. And during the 1990s, there were four hydroelectric relicensing projects that were through the relicensing process. Two involved Duke Energy projects. These are on the Broad River, of course. at Gaston Shoals and 99 Islands. One involved an SCNG hydroelectric project, that's the Neal Shoals Hydro, and of course Lockhart has one in Lockhart. And there were settlement agreements associated with each one of these hydroelectric relicensings in which these utilities agreed to fund certain monies for impacts to aquatic resources to go into this trust fund. So a good bit of money goes into this trust fund on an annual basis, and periodically we come to you with requests. Today we're presenting to you a proposal entitled Assessment of the Columbia Dam Fish Passage on Recruitment of Freshwater Mussels in the Broad River of South Carolina. There are four principal objectives. I won't go into those unless you want me to or to explain too much more about them. This is really a pretty straightforward proposal. I would next draw your attention to the second page of the package, which talks about the status of the Broad River Mitigation Trust Fund itself. Currently, there is over almost $946,000 in this trust fund, approaching $1 million. Projects previously approved have encumbered $192,000 plus. Those are obligated dollars. That gives us, as of today, $753,643 and change of available funds not obligated. Today we're requesting that you approve $82,675 from this fund for this particular proposal. Some quick math on the available funds not obligated and the anticipated revenue generated this fall. If we have over $753,000, almost $754,000 in the fund, and we ask you to approve almost $83,000 today, that would bring the fund down to $790,968. However, we anticipate at least $122,000, almost $123,000 to go back into the fund, so there's going to be a net improvement this fall, and that's not in counting the interest the fund will accrue or the inflation adjustment. So what I can tell you today is that with pretty good certainty, we believe the fund will be back up to about $800,000 this fall. So today we're asking for you to approve for this project $82,675.
Okay. Chair would entertain a motion.
I shall move.
Have a motion. Do we have a second? Motion and a second. Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, no. Motion carries.
Thank you, Mr.
Chairman.
Thank
you, Mr. Perry. Next up is the Hale Gold Mine Mitigation Carolina Hill Splitter Restoration Budget Approval. Ross Self of Wildlife and Freshwater Fisheries Division.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Director Taylor. I just, this is again a follow on to what Bob was just talking about. These are funds that will reside in that mitigation trust fund in the sub account to as part of the mitigation for the Hale Gold Mine. That package included $4.9 million to go toward the restoration and management of the Carolina Hill Splitters in that area, which is federally endangered mussel species. What we're here today is to ask for you to approve the first year's budget. It's about a 15-month budget that's presented to you in your package of about $350,000. The one caveat I will tell you about is that because of some health issues with folks outside the agency that are responsible for making those fund transfers, those monies have not been deposited into the sub-account at this point. We're expecting that transfer to occur next week. We're starting to spin up activities. The Fish and Wildlife Service is starting to spin up activities, so we would like to be able to access those funds as soon as they get there. So what we're going to ask you to do is to approve this budget contingent upon those funds being deposited into the sub-account. Portion of those dollars will be passed through to the Fish and Wildlife Service, who have jurisdiction over Carolina Hill Splitters. The bulk of it will stay with us. I think the services you get about $100,000. We'll retain about $250,000, which will fund a couple staff to work with the service on this restoration and recovery effort. as well as some hatchery activities that where we'll begin doing some production of Carolina Hill Splitters in one of our hatchery facilities there in Columbia. I'll be glad to try to answer any questions you might have.
No question. Do I have a motion?
Make a motion.
A motion for approval, Mr. Hutchins. Do I have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Ross, on the restoration, so you take the hill splitters to the hatchery and you raise the seed?
There'll be a couple of methods used here, and it will involve collecting some Carolina hill splitters from the wild, and they'll take them back to the hatchery and remove the reproductive organs, which are called glochidia. And in some cases, those are little parasitic life stages that attach to fish. Now, Carolina hill splitters are fairly generalist in the use of their host, so they'll attach to a number of different species. So some of this recovery effort will involve implanting those or having those that parasitic life stage, the glochidia, attached to a host fish, and then those host fish will be returned and stocked into the stream, and the mussel will continue to develop and fall off naturally within the stream. Another portion of that would be to do that same process in the hatchery, retain those fish on the hatchery until those glochidia transform into a young mussel. And grow those muscles out for a year and a half or 2 years to their juvenile size and then stock actual muscles. So it would be two different phases to the process.
Does it hurt the host for the
It does not. You know, generally a parasite, it's not in their best interest to do a lot of harm to the host. But an interesting thing associated with this is once a fish has been exposed to a glochidia or been implanted with a glochidia, it begins to develop resistance. So it's less likely that a subsequent exposure would result in a glochidia attaching. So we'll have to keep cycling through new host fish because of that resistance that develops in the process.
That's very interesting. Any questions? Where are we? Let's see. Do we have a motion? We do. We had discussion. That's right. We got the motion already.
We
already got that. All right, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Provided you don't give me a test on.
Mr. Poole, you will give us a presentation afterwards on what he learned today.
We can give you a very enlightening life cycle sheet.
Yes, he can.
If I went home and told my grandboys any of that, they wouldn't want to hear much more of the scientific stuff. But it's really cool how they attach themselves to host fish and then dropped off. They'll want to hear about that.
It's pretty fascinating.
It is fascinating. Okay. Let's see. Ross, Savannah Harbor Deepening Mitigation Sturgeon Monitoring Budget. So you're up again.
This is another one of those sub-accounts in the Mitigation Trust Fund. The mitigation for the Savannah Harbor Expansion Project involved about $3 million to South Carolina DNR to monitor Atlantic and short-nosed sturgeon in that lower Savannah to try and monitor the impacts of the deepening process. Those funds are in the sub-account, and this represents the first year budget for that. It's about $218,000. That'll pay for some staff time, and we'll purchase some more of the sonic receivers you heard about earlier and the transmitters that are used for that monitoring system. And we'll be monitoring sturgeon movements, habitat use, and doing some population estimations.
Okay. Entertain a motion.
We'll make a motion to approve that.
Motion to approve. A second.
Okay.
Have a second. Discussion. Sturgeon don't attach themselves to anybody else.
No, sir.
Okay. They probably spawn like salmon, don't they?
They do. They'll spawn on gravel bars. There's a couple of known gravel bars in that area, that lower end of the river that they're known to use, and we'll continue to monitor that to be sure that habitat doesn't change as the construction goes on lower down the systems.
Sounds good. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, no. Motion carries. If there's no objection, I'd like to call for about a 10-minute break.
Bill Post will be happy.
Okay.
First of all, I want to report, and Dick may do this later, but I want to report that our deer legislation passed out to Senate yesterday afternoon, got third reading, passed out. and now we'll cross over and be start debate on the House side. I've got several people I want to thank. It's been a road travel the last few weeks, and start with staff members that have been with me and others on the floor continuously as we've worked on this process. Charles Ruth did a fantastic job in testimony before the Fish, Game, and Forestry Committee. Mike Sabatha and Major Daniel Landrum have been very involved in meeting with members on the floor and back home, talking to them about answering questions that may have been out there about our deer legislation. Emily as well, in testimony and being available on the floor to just talk to people, to be available to answer questions. And those folks have just done a tremendous job. Also, I'd like to take a moment to thank one of our board members, Mr. Pulliam. During that period of time, he's made a lot of calls to folks to support not only my peer legislation and talk to them and take time to answer questions, but also follow up on turkey legislation as well. So just want to thank for that. Got several members yesterday came out. I'll tell you, came out one particular and said, "Please tell Mr. Pulliam that I voted with you today." I said, "Yes, sir, I will. I do that right now." So, but everyone, I know you've all received questions back home from our sportsmen. I thank you for support on these bills. The deer legislation still has a long path, but getting through the Senate and being able to answer a lot of those questions in that body certainly helps it move forward. So we were really excited yesterday to get third reading late yesterday afternoon and have it now passed the House. Update on our turkey legislation. I was told this morning before I got here that we thought conference committee on the turkey bill would be this week. They got involved in, as you may have seen on the House side with the budget, carrying out a lot of things with the budget, and it caused some of the planned meetings to be postponed, and it looks like it's been scheduled back for next Tuesday when they come back in with the conference committee. The conference committee on turkey legislation will only be debating and deciding on one thing, whether we're going to have a 2-bird-per-day limit or 1 bird for part of the season and 2 for the remaining part of the season. That's the only thing they'll conference on. And they'll make a decision on that, whether they'll accept the House side or the Senate side, and then it'll move on. There'll be no more discussion on the bill. So they'll make that decision hopefully next Tuesday.
Just remember you had a text from some council, so it should be next Tuesday.
Yeah, I got that word this morning too. So we feel like that'll be in a stage of being completed next Tuesday. So staff and members have spent a lot of time. They've done a lot of time invested in those two pieces of legislation, and many, many, many questions answered, not only from spending the time with members of our legislative body, but also constituents across the state. Just want to thank everyone for that. A lot of legislative meetings over a lot of different topics since last time we met. We completed our budget testimony in the Senate. That was yesterday morning for the subcommittee. We had our budget presentation for the subcommittee yesterday morning. Our subcommittee members on Senate Finance, Senator Sutzler from Lexington County chairs that committee. Senator Grooms from Berkeley and Senator Campbell from Berkeley Charleston and Senator Williams from Marion County are our budget subcommittee members. Had a good presentation, I believe, and so we'll move forward, and I'm sure we'll be getting some questions from them on the side as they start to develop the Senate budget. So we're in the Senate budget now, trying to develop that Senate budget. We'll have more information for you later. And as I hear things, I'll send messages out to you to give you some idea where we are. A lot of support on the Senate side. and we look forward to moving that process forward.
I will tell you that, and we had told the board that we were going to meet with Attorney General on having workshops, and Attorney General said our workshop procedure is fine, and so we'll move forward during the year having opportunities for providing workshops on some basis as we go through the coming year. I think they're very beneficial. Give staff a lot of time to explain Carolina Hill Splitters or whatever it may be to give you more information so as we move forward we can make good decisions as we manage our resources. So we did follow through that process and did get an opinion from Attorney General on our practice and our business method, and it is and we were doing things the right way. So we'll move forward with those as time goes on. I also had a meeting last week with the Georgetown Coalition, Migratory 45 Coalition. Folks came up and met with me one day, and you'll hear more and more about that as we manage our waterfowl in the Santee Delta area. I think we are on a good path. I think the inmate and her staff, especially Dean, they've done a lot of work in short order now with Dean being more involved as he's accepted the regional biologist job and being our waterfowl guy. He spent a lot of time in the Delta area recently. And we've got a great plan moving forward for the Delta region on our waterfowl management. I'm not saying we've done anything we shouldn't have, but we've got some exciting things, I think, moving forward there now. We'll be sharing with some of these groups out there as we move forward and try to negate some of the perception that may be out there about how we manage waterfowl in the Delta region.
Did Mr. Martin, did he show up?
Yes. And you'll hear more about that in the coming months. A couple of things I want to remind you of in the upcoming events. Our second Quail Council meeting will be Thursday the 26th. The chairman and I will be there for that. And so you're certainly welcome if you want to talk in and see what's going on as we move forward and try to put forth a quail plan for the state. You're more than welcome to participate. You all received invitations to Harry Hampton Board of Directors meeting scheduled at luncheon at Seawolves next week. That certainly is left up to you, but you've received those invitations to be a part of that Harry Hampton luncheon. Harry Hampton has been, again, one of our longtime partners, and they fund so many of our activities that we typically would not be able to fund and do. And so I would encourage you, if you can, to attend that. In front of you, you should have an envelope with your name on it. Those are tickets there are 10 tickets in there to use to the Sportsman's Classic that starts next weekend, next Friday. Please bring your family, bring friends, and come. It's South Carolina's number one outdoor show when it comes to hunting, fishing, boating, and other activities. So please, if you can, and if you have a close friend you know you can't, you can give those tickets to them. We'd love for them to come and participate. If you need more, if you see that you need more, let Sandy know or Robert McCullough know, and they will make sure to get those to you. That's what that is, and we hope you'll find some time during the weekend to come and spend some time out at the Classic at the fairgrounds.
Hope, what kind of weather we're going to have, you know yet?
I put in an order for perfect weather.
We'll have perfect weather.
We deserve a break from last year.
Also, April 16th through the 18th in Columbia on Lake Murray, the National Collegiate National Championship Fishing Tournament will be in South Carolina. Part of the, as far as Woods Cup, that's the professional guys.
It's FLW.
And this will be their collegiate national championship fishing tournament. It's pretty neat to think that you can get a scholarship now to go to college and fish. You know, I don't know. Somehow we miss that. I still be in college. But anyway, that national championship is going to be on Lake Murray. Again, that's two national
events this year that have taken place on Lake Murray, and one and a Bassmasters tournament during the coldest time of the year, Hope, on Lake Hartwell. And the question was asked of some of those folks, why you came to South Carolina, is because the fishing is so great. That rolls right back to Ross's staff and how they manage these public waters and stock these public waters and the work they're doing there. It speaks highly that everyone recognizes that South Carolina is a great place to fish. And it just says a lot for the work that our fishing staff are doing. So, Ross, please pass that on to your staff.
They do a heck of a
job in managing our public waters. Also, that's not on the list that I want to bring you up to date on, the things we're planning. We're currently planning a boating safety summit in South Carolina, which is, you know, South Carolina's 8th in the country in registered boats. We may be selling today. Looking at numbers, Derek, and boat registration numbers, we're very close to being selling. And there's been a lot of interest. We've had some very high-profile fatalities over the last year and a half in the state. Our fatality rates are actually down. But because there was some high-profile, it's brought awareness to boating safety in the state. We will be under a resolution from the Senate holding some public meetings in the coming summer, late spring and summer across the state around Marshall, so the public can come in and talk to us about boating safety where they vote. But before that happens, we're going to host a summit where we're going to bring other Coast Guard Auxiliary, Power Squad, and Coast Guard, some of our lake associations, some of our other agencies that enforce flooding laws, maybe some of the few sheriff's departments to do that. And we're going to sit down as the professionals that monitor this and talk about boating and safety in South Carolina before we get into the public meeting. So I will send you those dates, and if any of you would like to come and sit on that summit, we're going to host it. DNR is going to host it in the Columbia area, and I'll let you know those dates. If you'd like to come and sit in, you're more than welcome. I will promise you that some point in time between now and the end of summer, we will be in your area with some sort of public meeting. We're going to try to host about 8 public meetings, Senate meetings, out of state. We will host those for the public to have a chance to come in and talk. We're really excited about that. So, you know, we did this 10 years ago, a very similar that 10 years ago, as a result of some boating fatalities at that time as well, and it was well attended by the public. We got a tremendous amount of support from the public on moving forward with boating safety in South Carolina. A lot of other things on my list. If you have any questions, please feel free to give me a call. I will let you know when we start debating the House bill and the legislation. I'll send a blast out to you on that. Also would like to, and I would say, I think Rose sent a copy of a news article out of the Orangeburg paper, local paper, where former Chairman Johnny Evans sent in a rebuttal to someone that was opposed to our deer legislation.
Well, what should have been sent with that? Is that guy, that doctor?
Oh, we're getting ready to send that to you. We're going to send
it. Because I went online and found it. It was in the Orangeburg paper.
Right.
It was pretty darn, well, they called him an errand boy or a lackey or something like that. Some counts.
Yeah. So we worked with Johnny on that response. Charles Bruce spent a lot of time with Johnny on the response, and it was a great response. But we will make sure you get the original letter as well. But anyway, just wanted to make note of that. You saw that, and that was why that letter was sent out, because of previous editorial a week or so before it was in the paper. So, and Johnny's response, since he's in that area, that's his area that he lives in. So, anyway, that's our report for time being. If you have any questions, please feel free to give me a call. Any questions? Anyone have any questions?
Questions of the director? Okay, let's move on. Legislative report, Derek McGee, Legislative Services. Derek?
Just briefly, Alvin hit on the top three legislative package this year right now that's so focused on the deer legislation, the turkey legislation, and then the budget. Those three things have come up. manpower has been spent behind the scenes talking with the members, getting them prepped for it. But that fourth one would be the voting issue that Alvin brought up about the voting summit. That summit isn't just the, we're looking at the impact of voting, the safety issues, but it's also allowed us to take other bills, other legislation that people just throw out two or three ideas and put those back into keeping in the context of the safety issue. Everyone has an idea of what might work, and this allows those members who had those bills, they kind of stand down and they're waiting for this voting summit to go to these hearings to get more feedback from the general public. And at this point, once we get the Deer bill going, we'll have a few more, some internal housekeeping bills, and that will be, that's where we are on legislation.
Okay. Any questions of Derek? Thank you. Next up, environmental report, Bob Perry, Director of Office and Environmental Program.
Mr. Chairman, Director Taylor's comments about the fishing scholarship remind me that in 1972, when I was a senior at Carolina, I was accused by a couple of faculty members and one dean of thinking I was on fishing scholarship. But I'm glad to hear it's becoming official.
Yeah. Good.
My report's going to be brief. Yesterday we had a pretty high level meeting with some DOT staff members relative to I-73. And I wanted to advise you that they tell me that the bid proposals for the design build of I-73 will be open on May 7th. And presuming funding begins to fall in place for this project, the mitigation will be funneled through that design build. So actually the contractor who has the overall part of the project will be responsible for implementing the mitigation package, but we continue to work with DOT staff to formulate an excellent plan. On the Hale Gold Mine project, this is probably the last time you're going to see this one on our list, because we're going to conclude this project pretty soon. As Ross indicated earlier, we expect to sign a number of contracts, agreements, easement agreements, riparian rights agreements, and also the significant agreement with Hale Gold itself relative to the delivery of the mitigation trust funds. So those are important, but overall, the last minor things that have to be done. And our legal staff has worked very hard to ensure that these are real good agreements. And we thought that we would have had all of this in place by now, but it takes more time to do these final stages than we thought. Also, there were some very minor environmental issues associated with the mitigation projects. They were very, very minor. They were brought to light by our own staff in inspecting the buildings, as well as the contract agent who inspected. These were things that you would probably see on almost any rural or conservation property, you know, a few tires out behind the building, a drum of oil over here, waste motor oil. And when somebody comes in and they make a punch list on all of these things, we have to make sure that all of these things are taken care of, they're removed from the property, so we take it in a clean condition. So we expect all of this. I did an inspection on Cook's Mountain on Monday. It looks really good. There's one minor issue that needs to be taken care of. We reported that to the gold mine. They've also, on their own, discovered an illegal dump on Rainbow Ranch in Lancaster County. They're moving to take care of that. It was in a ravine that nobody has seen yet, but they did a good inspection during a leaf-off condition, and they were able to see that trash, and so they're in the process of removing it. So all these little minor details are finally coming to pass, and we're hoping that the closure will occur late next week.
And what about Goodwill?
Goodwill, Cooks, and Rainbow Ranch, and Hale Gold Mine closed with Mr. Falkenberry on the 27th of February. So Hale Gold Mine actually owns all three of the mitigation tracks now. And so we're just waiting on Hale to now transfer all of those tracks, be simple, to DNR. All the other agreements are in place, and we're moving forward. And that concludes my report, unless there are any further questions.
Any questions, Mr. Perry? Thank you, Bob. Next up, Deputy Director reports. Land, Water, and Conservation. Ken?
I don't have any additional items other than my monthly Heritage Trust revenue report that I put in front of each of you. And it's a little different from last month, but if you look at the history for February, it's a fairly slow month in February, so it's actually a pretty decent return. So heading in the right direction. If there are any questions about division activities, we'd be glad to answer.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
I thought we had agreed that we were going to take this back to 08 each time, because that's when all the downturn hit. And you said you'd get that taken care of.
Okay, I'll make sure I include that in the next one. We generate these, and they come to me, and I did not realize you want them back to 08 every time, but I can certainly do that, go back as far as you'd like.
Well, I think our reasoning was to see what the improvement in the economy and what the trend was.
Okay. We can certainly go back further. I'll do that for the next one.
When did we do that? I missed it.
We had a board meeting several months ago.
I remember the comment that came up.
And y'all said it would be no trouble doing it. We just thought it would be a good way to
track. It's not something we voted on or anything. It just came up. I asked them to do it, and they said they'd do it.
Okay. Question. This is what a point in play.
Correct. To do it that easily, how far can you go?
I think what Scott Spears told me was what we have readily available is back to 01. And the other data, we'd have to collect that from the treasurer's office. So I don't think that would be a useful issue.
It should be interesting to see if the data going back to 01, if it's easy to gather, just to see the trend.
I think so. I'd be glad to add more years. That's not a problem.
Okay. Next time.
Absolutely. Yes, sir.
Wildlife and freshwater fisheries. I don't think Emily's here. Is somebody going to report?
No report, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Thanks, Emily. law enforcement. Colonel Chisholm.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Director Taylor. I'll be brief. Our 14 officers are still at the academy. I've heard nothing but good things about them. I think academically they are all doing well, and they have come together as a group, so always glad to hear that. I think the director heard some good reports about him the other day with the head of the academy, so we're pleased about that. You mentioned earlier bike week. We're up to about 95-96 officers going to attend bike week, and so there's a lot of planning going on there, and we'll be there. We'll be ready, but a lot going on. Thank you for recognizing Greg Brown being Best Trader of the Year for IAMI. That's quite an accomplishment nationally to be named that. One thing I'd like to invite you all to is our state archery in the schools tournament is March 25th and 26th. We just had our regional tournaments to get there. It will be at the Sumter Civic Center. We would love to have you there. Probably got 750 kids coming to shoot. They'll do lower school, middle school, and high school on those 3 days. Lower school will be on the 25th. And the high school and middle school will be the next day. That's the tournament we've normally held during the Sportsman's Classic, so we'll be holding it in Sumter this year. But please let us know if you can come. It's pretty cool to see all those kids up there shooting. They probably shoot 50 kids at a time. Each kid's probably got his parents and a relative with him, so there are a lot of people there, a lot of excitement, and a lot of work's gone into that program. So if you can come, we'd love to have you all there. That concludes my report.
Thank you, Colonel. Any questions?
I'll make a comment. My grand boys participated in archery in Myrtle Beach the other month, and my daughter took them down there, and she was just struck by how organized they can take 400 and plus kids in a gym, and they're side by side with bow and arrows. That's pretty risky and strong. And they do it in an orderly fashion. They move right through it.
They had about 1,750 kids that they had to
really?
We narrowed down from that tournament now to the state tournament. So we'll have, you know, probably 750, about 1,750 shooting. But
It's quite a scene if you've never seen it. It's organized, but it is. There's a lot of excitement in the building. And I got to tell you, some of those kids are unbelievable archers.
You know something? In my opinion, that's our most precious resource.
No question.
It can be the fish and the birds and the, but those are the people that, and that's what we need to publicize. You know, we still tabloid journalism taking over, but. Well, and I'll make another light comment, you know, down at the, with these festivities at the beach.
Yes, sir.
And the Stone Ages at Daytona, when we go to spring break, they didn't have enough jails, so they brought out cattle trailers. And they just parked them on the beach, and when they got you, they just put you in a cattle trailer and stay there overnight or whatever you want. And they cleaned out the cattle trailer.
It's
another way that we can accomplish the objective.
You making a suggestion?
It was an uncomfortable Mr. Johnson.
You just could stand up. You couldn't sit down because there's so many people in there. But after you spent a night in the cattle trailer, you learned a valuable lesson.
Calm down.
We'll take that under consideration. We have a meeting leg coming up soon. You know, but if you look at the national events that have been going on with law enforcement and those types of things, there's pause for a lot of concern down there. So we've gone through with, you know, I don't know how many law enforcement officials will be there, but you got 95 DNR officers going, that's a telltale sign that there's a lot going on down there.
Yeah.
And, I'm very confident that our officers know how to treat people and can do well at it, but also very concerned about just the whole event, what's been going on in the nation. So,
I got a question about archery. If a child wants to participate, his school's not a member or in the association, can he come as an independent and try to qualify, or how does that?
They have homeschools that are part of it. If you want to do that, we'll be happy to make that happen.
Because I know a lot of schools, you know, like in my area,
I don't know if they can come to the state. I don't believe they can just come to the state tournament.
That's qualifying.
Qualify. But what we can do for next year is we can get them enrolled in the program so that they can go to the regionals to get to the state tournament.
And we also can send some of our coordinators to spend a little extra time in some of those schools to show them the benefit and what's going on a statewide level. Hopefully get the school to start participating in the program.
What's the avenue we'd have to go to get something implemented in a school? I mean,
we'll get one of our instructors, one of our coordinators to go talk to the school.
And they have a sponsor, I would imagine.
We provide the school with a first kit.
If you just call, we'll take care of it.
Okay.
It's really that simple.
Okay.
Just let us know. We'll get an instructor and see who's in the area that knows about the program, and we'll make it happen.
Okay.
That's not a problem. I'm happy to do that.
Question on location. Y'all had Myrtle Beach the last
one. Yes, sir.
Just an opinion. Most of these kids are participating in other sports, basketball, whatever that's going on in spring. With this side of the state, the west side, to travel 4 hours, they had to go and stay overnight. And I didn't know whether it was a more centralized location.
I'm sure there is. They put a lot of thought into that. With people being on spring break and other sports and trying to have it in a place that people would want to go to.
Yeah.
You know, and also other schools in the region.
Gotcha.
To try to coordinate the event in the area where you had the most participants. So, but that will change as we go through.
And let me just say that this is the first time we've done it this way. Mm-hmm. It's always all been held at Classic right there in one building,
right.
Central.
It got too big.
And they were doing all kind of renovations at the fairground. So this year we had to figure out how we were going to do it a little bit differently. So I'm sure as they finish the fairgrounds and we get things done, that we'll come back to at least look at it again.
Just an opinion.
Yeah.
But we'd love to have any of you all at the tournament either way. It's a showcase for the ages.
I've seen some of them. This
really is
unbelievable.
Questions?
Okay, questions of Colonel? A little takeoff on what Larry said about children being our most precious resource. I remember at my house, I had to come in at 11 o'clock, even when I was going to college, when I came home, because I was driving Daddy's car. But if I wanted to go set hooks or go possum raccoon hunting, or I wanted to do one of those things, Daddy would say, you can stay out all night. And so what that was with archery, I mean, you're giving these kids something, because he said nothing bad is going, you're not going to be involved in anything bad if you're involved in that. And so with archery, that's what we're doing. A lot of these kids don't have the opportunity to do those things, and if you can teach them archery or hunting and fishing, it carries for the rest of their life. It resulted in a lifelong love affair with the outdoors for me. And so we're giving that to some kids, and that's good.
I comment on that, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
Just to follow up on archery in schools, but also in our whole shooting sports program. You know, our here on this facility in April, we'll be hosting the state's first event of this size in an open shooting sports competition for high school students, 4-H students, clubs, four club shooters. Here at what you'll see after we eat lunch today, and you know there are already more than 400 shooters signed up for that to be here and that tournament, and then that just goes right on across the state as the year goes on into a state tournament there as well. And, you know, to take it a step further, we laughed about the scholarships for fishing, but there'll be scholarships and awards to as part of this shooting sports tournament. Because most of your colleges now have shooting teams. And, you know, it's a club sport in many colleges, but they actually offer, you know, scholarship opportunities for shooting in most of your colleges, especially in the Southeast, and it's spreading across the country. So all of these things involving young people and those types of opportunities are tremendous. And
yes,
we are a major player, major, major player in that in South Carolina. So.
Yeah.
And we have great partners that help us with that.
Okay, next up, Marine Resources, Deputy Director Robert Boyle.
Nothing further, Mr. Chairman.
Robert.
I can dance.
Dance.
Let me see.
Okay, Robert, dance. I was just joking. Outreach and support services, Derek McGee.
I've got three things I want to hit on. We have turkey, boating, and IT real quickly. As of this morning, we issued about 75,097 turkey tags going out, but 500 have been returned. We recognized a couple process issues. The current turkey contract, which expires this year, required a delivery date to the department no later than February 20th. As we renew that contract, we're going to push that back, that we have a delivery date so we can spread that time out. It's a 20-week process from bid to filling it, so we'll start that this July. The second issue we found was a system process. The old system used to say, do you want turkey tags? And it elicited the person to answer yes or no. What we found was that the vendor, was checking yes for folks. So we were getting thousands of people who were getting turkey tags who called us and said, why are you sending us turkey tags? So now there's an affirmative. You have to check off that you want a tag, just like you want any other privilege. And a lot of people thought that they had that privilege and did not. And we found that when we went out, even though they thought they had gotten, a lot of them thought they had gotten tags, they never actually ordered the privilege. Within there are some people who have a multi-year tag that a multi-year license, first year, they may have gotten turkey tags, but they need to ask also those other years. So we're going to be working on that process in the coming year, starting with backing the date back up so we can have an earlier delivery date. Second issue on boating, we're in the process of hiring 5 customer service specialists downstairs. We've been down to about 8 to 9. I reported the first month when I got here. It amazed me that, as Alvin talked about, the number of boats look like we're going to go up to number 7 on the list. Those 8 people transacted from about April to September, 16,000 transactions a month. And dealing with titles and strictly titles and registration. So we're trying to put in a new training regimen, actually I've had staff working on actually a standard operation practice guide to actually be the instruction to teach. Because right now, historically being an older agency, you learned on the job at that point. But we're bringing in a new group of people with a new system we've got in place, and that guide is just about finished. And last but not least, from an IT perspective, our assistant IT director finishes, Terry, the previous month. Our current IT director submitted his resignation pending May 1, April 30th, April 2nd. So we are, without the IT director and assistant director, we had that job posted. I think it's closed either yesterday or today. And we are ready for the assistant director, but I thought it more prudent to wait till the director gets in place so he can then select his assistant. But we also have two other positions that are ready for the interview stage. That's the database administrator, the assistant database administrator, because we have one on staff now, and then the GIS expert to help with the maps that need to be produced ASAP. With
that, sounds good. Any questions for Mr. McGee? Yes?
Derek, in order to be seventh in the nation now, if that's what we are, how many votes do you think that is?
485,000.
485,000?
Yes. We're up about 25,000 from last year, I believe.
And from a licensing standpoint, I'm thinking active is about 360, 375, but total count is at 400.
That's a bunch of votes.
Fourth per capita, that even speaks more for what.
Okay, any other questions? All right, comments from the board? Here?
No comments.
All
right. I'd like to speak to you afterwards. I have a suggestion for a topic at the next meeting.
Okay.
I think the board would be extremely interested in. And secondly, somebody.
That's me.
That's you?
You tried to give it to me.
I was there looking. I saw it over there. I was trying to go for my telephone. Going through my email.
You guys need to get your stuff together over there. Go ahead, Mr. Tucker.
I'm good.
That's it. Mr. Poyer?
I'm good.
Mr. Love?
Good.
Yeah?
Good.
No comment from me. I believe we have to go into executive session, so lunch is about ready. We're going to eat across the way. If we can go into executive session now, and then we'll go get our food, bring it in here, and we'll wrap up. After that, George Thornton's coming. He's going to give us a brief presentation, and we're going on a tour. That sound good? Okay, motion second. All those in favor, aye. Motion carried. Call the meeting back to order. I was remiss in not telling you why we were going on into executive session. It was to discuss some reappointments for conservation districts and also to discuss some property issues. So that's why we went into executive session. But no action was taken during executive session. So do I have a motion to come out of executive session?
So moved.
I have a motion to have a second.
Second.
All those in favor say aye. So we're back in regular session now. Okay, so we have a couple of action items we'd like to put forward. And first one is some reappointments. And Mike, I believe you're going to...
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion to approve the appointments and reappointments from the Conservation District based on the recommendation from the Conservation District. The names are as follows. Henry Nicholson from Danburg, Rebecca Davidson Barnwell, William Simpson from Charleston, William Griggs from Chesterfield, I.M. Fenton from Collington, C.M. Dampster from Jasper, W. Gordon Wells from Jasper, E. Michael Otelli, Marlboro, H. Keith Keel from Richland, Jason Rice from Saluda, Ronnie Bullard from Spartanburg, Norris Tyler from Union, Jane Carston from Williamsburg, and those are reappointments. The appointments are Jimmy Poston from Florence, Richard Sansbury from Florence, Richard Dugan from Greenville, and Jeffrey Jeffrey Laney from Richmond.
Okay.
I'll second that motion.
Second. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, no. Motion carries. Help me with the second one. Let's see. Prompt preliminary approval of the course evaluation proposed property in 91 acres. Okay. Okay, second one. Oh, yeah, but I'm just going to say what it is. Okay, go ahead.
I'd like to make a motion for preliminary approval to evaluate the proposed purchase of 91 acres adjoining DNR's Bear Island, WMA, in Colleton County.
We have a motion.
Second.
Do we have a second? I have a second. Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, no. Motion carries. Thank you, Elizabeth. Thank you, Alan. Okay, we have one additional item, I believe, Kerry's going to cover.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion for the preliminary approval to evaluate the proposed purchase of 357 acres adjoining DNR's Chestnut Ridge, WMA, Heritage Preserve in Greenville County.
Okay, we have a motion. Do we have a second? Second. Okay, discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, no. Motion carries. Okay, next meeting will be a workshop planned for the third Thursday of April. And that would be the 16th. So just kind of jot that down, but we'll send you more specific information. Anything else to come before the board today? Okay, let's adjourn over to the big hall to see a presentation by the National Wild Turkey Federation. Okay? Thank y'all.